morning.
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 Okay, so this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I like to see that. I just love to see that. Witnesses to the glory of God in the face of Jesus will be unable to avoid reflecting what glory in the world, but reflecting that glory in the world. It was true for Moses. It was doubtlessly true for Peter, James, and John. And we pray that it will be true for all of us who see the glory of the Lord in the Word and the Supper and who are being transformed into the same image by the Spirit of God. And this Wednesday, Ash Wednesday, services will be at 7:30 a.m. in the morning. So if anybody has to go to work, they can get up and go to Ash Wednesday services real quick and then wear their ashes all day, which tells everyone exactly who you are. It's a form of evangelism as well as a witness to faith. So next Sunday will be the first Sunday in Lent, and we will begin an adult forum in the Reformation Room. That's the room directly to the west, or you know, go up to the breezeway, and it's right across from the Fireside Room. It will begin at 8:30 a.m. The main topic will, of course, be the Holy Scriptures, but other religious issues will also be under consideration as seems appropriate. Your Lenten devotions are here, and you're able to, they're available in the back if you wish to pick them up at the back of the sanctuary. All peace-loving people throughout the world are greatly disturbed by the recent developments in the country of Ukraine. The naked aggression displayed by Vladimir Putin is reminiscent of the days of Adolf Hitler, more than 80 years ago. In view of this, following the blessing before the closing hymn, we will have a very brief prayer service for peace. For those who would like to help, those who are so much in need as they can endure these unprovoked attacks, you may do so by contributing through Lutheran World Relief. The address is posted in the bulletin, on the bulletin board in the Fireside Room. So you can just pick that up. It's not an issue. If you need it, we'll point it out to you. So those are our announcements for today. And we should start our service with opening hymn of
252. Pardon me, I'm heading this way because I don't believe the PA is on.
Did everybody get to hear me?
Yes.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthy magnify our holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you in our core of our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may be right and well, and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God, and bestows on them the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of God, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, mighty and immortal, you are beyond our knowing, yet we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. Transform us into the likeness of your Son, who renewed our humanity so that we may share his divinity. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. First reading is Exodus chapter 34, verse 29 to 35. Moses came down from Mount Sinai, and as he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hand, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, The skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him. And Moses spoke with them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him at Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites that he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the skin of his face was shining. And Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm today is Psalm 99. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord. Worship upon God's holy hill.
The Lord is the King who has set the people on the ground. He is enthroned upon the pyramid and let the earth shake.
The Lord is great in Zion. He is high above all peoples.
Let them confess his name with his praise and offer. He is the Holy One.
O mighty King, the Lord of justice, you have restored your integrity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob.
Proclaim the greatness of the Lord, our God, and fall down before the fulfilled. He is the Holy One.
Moses is Aaron among his priests, and Samuel among those who call upon his name. They call upon the Lord, and he
see Moses' face because of the veil, but in Christ we see the unveiled glory of God and are transformed into Christ's likeness. Second reading, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 12, and chapter 4, verse 2. Since then, we have such a hope, we act with great boldness, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face, to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory that was being set aside. But their minds were hardened, indeed, to this very day. When they hear the reading of the Old Covenant, that same veil is still there, since only in Christ is it set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us, with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we commend ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, his appearance on his face changed, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen, listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent. And in those days, they told no one any of the things they had seen. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Testing. Is this working?
Yeah, I think so. Is it green there?
Hello.
There we go. There it is.
So this is the Feast of the Transfiguration of our Lord. Now, I don't know about you, but I never, ever hear or see or use the word transfiguration, except on this particular day. So I had to look it up in the dictionary to see what, in fact, does transfiguration mean? And I was told it means to be changed in form, to be changed in figure. This is a strange story, but it's repeated in each of the four Gospels, the transfiguration of our Lord. Some say it was just a dream that the disciples were having. After all, the gospel lesson says they were sleepy, so maybe they were dreaming. Others say it's kind of a mini version of Easter Sunday. And others say it's simply intended to highlight the majesty, the glory, the honor in which we hold Jesus. One commentator referred to this as a glory story. So we'll go with that. This is a glory story, a story intended to highlight Jesus' glory. I read the story, and you know that Jesus and three of his disciples, Peter, James, and John, went up to the top of a mountain, and there a number of things happened. Jesus' face shone like the sun, his garments became dazzling white. One of the Gospels say so white that no fuller could bleach them that white. Then Moses and Elijah appeared to Jesus and carried on a conversation. Oh, no one explains how Peter, James, and John actually knew this was Moses and Elijah. Then there's a cloud that descends on the mountain, and out of the cloud comes a voice saying, "This is my son, the beloved, listen to him." And then Peter, who's usually big, bold, brash, impetuous, Peter suggests that three booths or tabernacles be constructed, one for Moses, one for Elijah, one for Jesus himself. And then they head down the mountain. And Jesus tells them not to say anything to anyone about what they'd seen and heard. This is a glory story. Let's look at the elements of the story individually very briefly. First, this dazzling appearance of Jesus. You know, in that first lesson, we had the story of how when Moses went to the top of the mountain, Mount Sinai, to get the Ten Commandments, he encountered God kind of face to face, and his face glowed from the glory of being in God's presence. My wife and I were talking the other day about a toy that my daughter used to sleep with when she was little. It's called Glow Worm. This was a glorified flashlight. The top of the flashlight where the light is was shaped to look like a doll's face. The body of the flashlight, where the batteries were, was covered in green cloth. And when she would squeeze the body, the flashlight would come on. The worm would glow. So Jesus in this story is kind of the ultimate glow worm. One who has seen the face of God directly, and he glows. Then Moses and Elijah show up. Now Moses and Elijah are considered by the Jewish people to be the most important folks in the Old Testament. Moses is the one to whom the Ten Commandments were given, and Elijah was the prophet who was considered to be the most important spokesperson for God in his time. So you have the law and the prophets both represented as talking to Jesus, again, highlighting Jesus' importance, Jesus' glory. Then there is a cloud, and a cloud is oftentimes represented in the Bible as saying that God is there. And there's a voice from the cloud. My voice isn't so good at the moment, but voice from the cloud booming out, "This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him." Clearly the voice of God pointing out that Jesus is the Son of God and commanding that Jesus be listened to, not just on the mountaintop, but down in the valley too. And then Peter. You know, Peter gets a lot of criticism for his suggestion here that there be three booths constructed, one for Moses, one for Elijah, one for Jesus. And the commentators say there's two ways you could look at. One way is, you know, as you and I drive down the highway, we see all kinds of signs saying that this bridge or this overpass or this highway is in memory of so-and-so. So maybe Peter wanted to kind of remember Jesus going forward. Maybe that was why he did that or made that suggestion. That's the positive view of Peter. The more negative view of Peter, I think of a woman in one congregation I served named Lorraine. And Lorraine's husband died. And for years afterwards, Lorraine refused to get rid of his clothes or any of the other things that she associated with him. She wanted to hold on to her husband. Refused to admit he was gone. Maybe that was Peter's idea. Maybe Peter wanted to cling to Jesus and refused to allow him to go back down in the valley where Jesus himself had predicted he would suffer and die. Well, after all of those things happened, that the disciples and Jesus descend the mountain. Jesus says, "Now don't say anything. Be quiet. Wait until
wait until I have really come into my glory. But of course, the story itself is a glory story. It points to the fact that Jesus is in a special relationship with God Himself, indeed is God Himself. So when they get down in the valley and go to Jerusalem, and Jesus suffers and dies, Jesus is betrayed, Jesus is deserted, Jesus and Peter, James, and John can look back to what they saw happen on the mountain and can say, God hasn't deserted him. God is still with him. He's doing exactly what God wants. This Feast of the Transfiguration is a lot of biblical scholars call a pivot story. Up to this point, Jesus has been teaching, preaching, healing people. And now, and mostly in Galilee, but now he's going in the southern part of the Holy Land to Jerusalem, where he's going to suffer and die. His face is set to go to Jerusalem. And so the people who put together the lectionary, which is the series of readings that we read each Sunday in church, those folks put the story of the Transfiguration, the Feast of the Transfiguration, precisely at the end of the Epiphany season, as we anticipate moving into Lent. Epiphany means manifestation, revelation. During the Sundays since the Christmas season, we've been hearing miracles, teachings of Jesus that point to the fact that he is indeed God's own special Son. That Jesus is glory of God revealed. Now, starting Wednesday and Ash Wednesday, we're going to be journeying toward the cross. And we, like Jesus and Peter, James, and John, need to look back to the Transfiguration as we're moving forward toward the cross, to remember that Jesus' death, Jesus' arrest, trial, persecution, Jesus' crucifixion does not mean that God has deserted him. Rather, it's an affirmation of the fact that God is with him, in him, and that God is working through him to redeem us all. It's a glory story that we have today, and it prepares us for the gory story that we're about to hear in the next few weeks. Amen.
in the words of the Nicene Creed as we say together.
We believe in one God, the Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified by Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Spirit. He ascended into heaven. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He spoke through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism. We look for the resurrection of the dead, the life of the world to come. Amen.
Rejoice with all the faithful, we pray, for the church and all those in need. God of glory, guide and empower your church leaders to trust your promises as Moses and Elijah did. Shine the light of Christ through your church to the world. Be with all bishops, pastors, deacons, and lay leaders. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of majesty, the heavens declare your glory, and the firmament shows forth your handiwork. Help us to be good stewards of your creation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of hope and freedom, give just laws, fair leaders, life's necessities, and abundant peace to all nations. Be with our President and Congress, Governor, and Legislature. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of mercy, be with all who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit, especially those we now name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of new life, show us your will for our St. Paul's congregation and use us for mission and witness as you lead us into a future known to you alone. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Glory of God, we thank you for revealing yourself in the lives of those who've gone before us with the sign of faith whom we now name in our hearts. May light perpetual shine upon them. Bring us with them into the fullness of your glory, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer. Into your loving hands, gracious God, we place ourselves and all our prayers, spoken and unspoken, trusting your mercy, to Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
Now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Just share a sign of peace. We're all very distant this morning. Peace be to you. We do have a birthday today. Just a minute, I'll get my mask on here. And that is Emily Miller. Please come forward for our birthday blessing. Together.
O God, our time is in your hand. Look at the favor we pray your servant Emily as she begins another year. Grant that she may grow in wisdom and grace
strengthen their hearts to your goodness all the days of their life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty, I knew how you were telling. Yes, I married her mother and father, and I baptized her. She's just part of our little family here. Any other announcements? I think that all the announcements have been given. Next Wednesday, to repeat, we'll have service here at 7:30 in the morning for ashes. And then following week, we're going to have our soup suppers to look forward to. And we'll have a soup supper, then a presentation. I understand Aaron has a film about the times of Luther, which we're looking forward to. And then following that will be a brief devotion, something to help along our Lenten path. And as was mentioned, our devotionals are available for Lent at the back of the church.
While we're on that topic, Sandy and Pastor, what time have we determined for the soup supper?
What time did we determine?
What did you determine? Wasn't it six?
Six, I think.
Okay.
6 o'clock.
Yeah.
And the bread will be provided, and the soup will be, if you want to sign up, you can still sign up to make soup when you've got a sign up sheet.
Six o'clock on Wednesdays following Ash, but not next Wednesday, that'd be Ash Wednesday, but the following Wednesday will start. Walk in love as Jesus Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and sacrifice to God.
Salutary, that we should at all times and all places
offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ the Lord. Sharing our life, he lived among us for your glory and love, that our doctor should give way to his own brilliant light. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy,
holy, holy, holy, holy,
holy
Lord,
God,
power, and might,
heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna,
Hosanna,
Hosanna
in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O God. You surround us with your glory and mercy. And the splendor of your heavenly light, you lead us through the darkness of this world. You led your people Israel by a pillar of fire. And you promised them, as you delivered them from bondage, and brought them to the promised land. From the light of Bethlehem star, you led the sages to your beloved son, revealing him to the nations as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In words and signs and wonders, your son gave the light, hope, to the disappointed, and leading to the disenchanted. Then at the appointed time, he stretched out his hands on the cross, throwing forth the brilliance of the life, freely given, that all may have life and faith. This same Lord Jesus, on the night of his betrayal, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for my remembrance." When supper ended, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "All of you drink of this, for this cup is new cup. Is my blood of new covenant, shed for you and for all people, forgiveness of sins. Do this for my remembrance." In joy, we proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ is died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Gracious Father, we give you our thanks for the life of your Lord's passion, our Lord's passion, and his victory over the grave. We rejoice that you have made us for people, objects of Christ's redeeming love. We pray that by the Holy Spirit you will bless and sanctify this Holy Communion, that we may be filled in faith as we partake of Christ's body and blood, renew the forgiveness of sins, and joy us in the hope of your eternal kingdom. Together, through him,
with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit,
all honor, glory,
and glory,
Almighty
Father,
now and forever.
Amen. Lord, remember us your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
The light has shattered the darkness. Together, let us follow
the star and behold our God.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us.
Lamb
of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us.
Lamb
of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. think we can sing the post-communion hymn here. Come with us, O blessed Jesus, with us evermore to be, and in the vineyard of thy altar, let us evermore be. Let thy bright celestial chorus never cease the heavenly strain, but in us thy loving children come, bring peace, goodwill to all.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of the godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his through the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace now and forevermore. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now before our final hymn, as I said, I would invite us to have a brief service of intercession for the people in Ukraine and for peace in general. The response to the intercessions are, Lord, have mercy. And I invite you to either sit with bowed head or kneel as you are so disposed. In peace, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. For peace in Eastern Europe, that the Lord may bring an end to the war and restore peace and freedom to the people of Ukraine, let us pray.
Lord, have mercy.
The children and young people, that the Lord may preserve them in body and soul from suffering and injury, let us pray.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have political responsibility, that the Lord may direct their hearts to peace, that he may help them to serve truth and justice, that he may guard the hearts and minds of people from error and falsehood. Let us pray.
Lord, have mercy.
For peace and harmony in our country, that the Lord may prevent the polarization of society into opposing interest groups, that he may give and keep peace in workplaces, universities, and schools, that he may give new strength to teachers and keep their love, let us pray.
Lord, have mercy.
For peace in our homes and families, that the Lord may help spouses who have a hard time with each other, that he may give good understanding between generations, so that children may grow up in peace, and for unborn children, let us pray.
Lord,
have mercy. For an end to the worldwide pandemic, that the Lord may preserve people from sickness, that he may give new strength to nurses and doctors, for all who are sick, and those whose names you mentioned here in silence. Let us pray.
Lord, have mercy.
For our church and congregation, that the Lord may keep us in his truth, that he may raise up young people willing to enter his service, for seminaries and universities everywhere they may teach the truth. The Lord may establish teachers and learners in his word. Let us pray.
Lord, have mercy.
Merciful God, keep us in your peace and grant peace to all people for whom we have prayed. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who has taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now our final hymn, number 654. Hymn 654.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.